Let's continue our second talk. Steve from Apprenda.
Hey guys, so I'm gonna run you through, give you an introduction to the Kubernetes Enterprise Toolkit. A little bit about myself. Basically, I'm SWade1987, pretty much everyone on the internet, GitHub and Twitter. I'm a solutions architect at Apprenda. So for those of you who don't know what Apprenda is, basically we've got two arms. We've got our original cloud platform, where we take .NET and Java applications, and we allow them to be able to run in a containerized environment. And back in March last year, we acquired Kismatic, and being able to have those guys with us enables us to be able to start to leverage Kubernetes under the hood. So we've got two kind of arms. We've got Kismatic, which will allow us to be able to do services within Kubernetes, but we're also going to run Kubernetes under the hood with our cloud platform. So what I'm going to show you guys here today is the Kubernetes Enterprise Toolkit. So this is the culmination of about 3 months' work by a small team of guys based out in New York, looking at the best practices and the things that we've seen with our clients to basically allow us to be able to provision infrastructure and a Kubernetes cluster as quickly as we can, but also with the best practice. So whether that be with you don't have the storage doesn't have access to the internet, or whether that's you're in your own private data center, or whether we're in the Amazon on the cloud, or whether we're in Packet. So the demo that I'm going to run you through is basically using Packet.net. So hands up if anyone has actually heard of Packet.net. Okay, a couple of you. So what Packet.net is basically a very, very stripped down version of AWS that allows you to be able to create bare metal instances in the cloud for you to be able to access. So before we start, I want to ask a few questions. How many of you have provisioned it from scratch? Hands up. Okay, keep your hands up if it's, hold on, keep your hands up. If it took longer than 2 days, keep your hands up.
Longer than 2 days.
Get longer than 2 days.
No.
Okay.
Just 1 day.
Okay, a day? Longer than a day? Okay, so I'm gonna try and do it within 10 minutes. So from having a set of infrastructure that we've already got running up and running on Packet to provisioning a fully working cluster with Calico for the networking. So I'm going to try and do it in 10 minutes. So please don't use the guest Wi-Fi because it's probably going to cripple my demo. So what's the goal of this talk? The goal of this talk is basically to demonstrate how this toolkit is going to make all you ops guys' lives easier. So we're going to start with a scenario. So everyone in the audience is an ops guy. And the devs have gone to a meetup and they've heard about this Kubernetes thing and they've gone, cool. Okay, I'm just gonna boot up Minikube on my local machine, run a couple of containers. Great. So you guys are in a meeting room and the devs are there and the ops guys are there and the devs guys are going, okay, well come on guys, we really need a cluster right now. The ops guys are like, well, don't really know where to start, how to configure it and what tools to use. So the first thing they do, as they do what any respectable engineer does, basically goes to Google and they do a little browse, go in here, they search
how to install,
how to install Kubernetes. Yeah.
No, I'm feeling lucky.
So they click the first link and it goes to the Kubernetes website and they think, oh my, what a lot of information that we've got to read here. The devs guys are not going to wait for me to read through all of this, it's going to take ages. However, what they should have done is they should have gone to Google and they should have typed in Kubernetes Enterprise Toolkit. Yeah, I'm gonna need to loo in about 5 minutes if I keep going. So this is the toolkit that the guys in New York created. Basically allows you to be able to, as it says here, so it allows you to be able to design, deploy production Kubernetes cluster. So the rest of this talk, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna run you through a set of scenarios where we're gonna provision the cluster, we're gonna deploy some applications on it, and then we're gonna add a new worker node to that cluster. So I've already created a set of nodes that are basically running Ubuntu on Packet. So obviously every ops guy should be able to create 10 VMs that are running the operating system. So if we take a look at the Kismatic, can you guys see this again? At the back. So this is the cluster. This is the cluster.yaml. This is basically the process behind it. The Kismatic Enterprise Toolkit basically takes this to provision the cluster. So we can see out here we've got the name of the cluster, Kubernetes. We've got the admin password. So this is the password that's going to be used to access the dashboard. And we've got a set of other options. So we've got allow package installation to be false. So for this demo, basically what I'm going to show you is if we don't have access to the internet. You can set this to true. It'll go off to our repository in S3, pull down the latest Kismatic packages, uninstall them, and then provision the cluster. We've got networking overlay here. We can set this to routed, so we can have Calico in overlay or routed mode. So maybe in production we would want it to be routed. In dev and staging we may want it to be overlay. Then we've got a cedar block range. We can enable the policies to just true or false. So this is a Calico. We can enable the Calico policies. With the option to update the host files to true, so that basically all the nodes can talk to each other. Then we can set the certificates to have an expiry date. By default, it's just set to 2 years, but obviously, if you're running this in production, 2 years is probably not the best thing to be using. Then we need the SSH access, so that we need to pass in a key, so that basically Kismatic can SSH into those nodes and run the Ansible playbooks that are basically going to provision the cluster. Node port, and we've got a Docker registry. So here we can have this as true or false. So in my demo, we're going to have it as true. So basically this will create us a little Docker registry locally. And when it pulls down those packages, it will store those Docker images locally. But obviously you could have this in Docker Hub, you could have this in Artifactory, it depends. So here's basically the crux. So we're saying here we're going to have 3 etcd nodes with the host name and IP addresses. We're going to have 2 masters, 3 workers, and then we're going to have an ingress node. So it's going to construct us the ingress node. So now it's going through. It's doing, as you can see here, it's doing a set of pre-flight checks. So it does a set of prerequisites. It's updating the host files. It's running, so like I said, it's running a set of pre-flight checks. What it's doing is it's making sure that the Kismatic tool can basically SSH into all of the nodes. There's connectivity there. Because we obviously don't want to start running this tool and we get halfway through, provision 3 etcd nodes, and then the thing crashes because you can't talk to the masters and the workers.
Does this support actually sort of like downscaling, upscaling the cluster later? If you were to change nodes from 10 down to 5, would it?
Not currently, but it's something that's going to be released in Q1 of this year.
Cool.
So,
what operating systems does it support to deploy on?
So we've got Ubuntu, we've got CoreOS, we've got Red Hat, we've got CentOS. So we're trying to make it OS agnostic as much as possible, so that you guys can make your decisions. As long as you can provide us some infrastructure with an OS installed on it that we can have access to via SSH, we can pretty much do that.
Apprenda did a very good job supporting Kubernetes on Windows.
Yes.
Are you also going to include Windows?
Yes, eventually. There's still a lot of work going on behind the scenes at Apprenda. We're working with Microsoft and Google.
Thanks very much.
Yes. Yeah, I don't have to deal with that pain, but I know a lot of guys that are dealing with it.
Also mentioned that KET is open source.
Yes, I'm going to mention that again. Hey.
Are you doing for monitoring?
Currently there's no monitoring, but we're going to build in a set of defaults around monitoring. So we're going to use Prometheus. I'm going to use Vault for secrets. We're going to use Linkerd for tracing. So it's all this kind of stuff's coming, but we've only a couple of months of work, and for developers is kind of, we wanted to try and be able to provide something that you could pick up and use with regardless of the OS. So one of the next things that we're being built on at the moment is storage. So you're going to say that you want a couple of nodes for Gluster, and we will provision you a Gluster cluster for you, and then we're going to upgrade.
And
hey.
Is it still running?
Yeah, it's still running. So let me just quickly go through what's going on, and then I'll come back. So we're installing the etcd cluster here. We're installing the network etcd cluster. So Calico needs two etcd clusters, one for the routing of Calico and one for actual Kubernetes. Then it's installing Docker. It's configuring the registry. I really like this because it's really verbose. And for an operator that's never installed Kubernetes before, it's pretty obvious what's going on. So yeah, it's loading some images now. Sure, so anyone else? Hey.
So you mentioned that hosts, the VMs were pre-provisioned, right?
Yes.
So whenever you're going to scale it up or down, will you support different backends on the EAS level? I mean, clearly more VMs.
So this tool is basically built for you to give us the infrastructure, and we'll provision the cluster. We're not yet, and I'm not sure if it's on the roadmap that we will provision existing like new infrastructure.
So you can only scale up within the boundaries of your.
Yes. So a lot of clients that we work with have their own private data centers. So the idea is that they will provision the core OS cluster for us, and then they'll execute this tool. Anyone else? There's 9 more steps. Well, 8 more steps.
It's working.
Of course it's working. Practice this 80 times. So basically one of the other steps you'll notice is that we actually we provision an ingress node by default so that we can basically start deploying straight away and get that up to speed. So that's running Nginx under the hood.
So all of these components are deployed inside a container or do they run as services on like
some of them run as services, some of them run as containers.
How are you doing cloud provider support for different clouds?
So at the moment it's only supporting AWS and Packet, but we're not kind of looking at building a Terraform. So one of the things that I did in my previous organization is I did a lot of stuff on AWS and I built a lot of stuff with Terraform. This kind of isn't around that kind of area. We're looking more at kind of private data centers more than anything else. So a lot of our clients are more enterprise, they have their own private data centers. So it's not kind of built around cloud, but it can be run on the cloud. We have the ability to be able to run this on AWS if we wanted.
But you mean you have AWS support from a Kubernetes perspective, then?
Yes.
Not from an infrastructure.
We don't have the...
If I run it on my own bare metal server farm,
yes.
Will it also work? Or do I need to provide something else like the implementation?
You will need to provide some load balancers, or you can just point it straight at the ingress node that you create. Then one of the other things that I like is that it starts to run a set of smoke tests as well. So after this, basically the provisioning is finished, now it runs a set of smoke tests. So these smoke tests are like the guy said, so that if we create some pods, we make sure the port forwarding works, we make sure that the routing between all of the nodes on the network is working. Yeah, there's a bug here. I was hoping that no one would actually notice this, but it turns out that everyone's actually noticed this.
So this is part of the smoke test, right?
Yeah, the smoke test is to actually do it in the wrong order and make sure that it works. So yeah, we obviously provisioned this cluster in under 10 minutes, like I said, so we did it in 6 minutes 32, so that's 23, even better. So now... So you better go in here, this will be out now. So we've got a cluster up right. So the Opsco thing, cool, right? Well, you know, we've got a cluster up and running, I can hear the dashboard. But like, you know, any good engineer, he's not going to give it to the devs if it's just, you know, if he can just hit the dashboard. He wants to prove that it's actually going to work. So what we'll do is we'll go ahead and deploy a little application. Wow, I knew that was going to work. Oh, okay. I know what
it's called. CD.
So go ahead and deploy this application. Live demos. I'm definitely not Kelsey Light to RMI. This would have worked straight away. Okay, let's come back to that.
They're not ready yet.
They're running. Is it pulling the images from?
No, they're not ready.
Right, so we can see, we can restart this, and it's going to the different workers that we provisioned.
Right.
So that's great, that's working. So imagine we've given it to the dev teams. They're like, whoa, this is awesome. You know, you've provisioned a cluster in under 10 minutes. But however, we've got so many apps that we actually want you to, can you add us another worker node? So, luckily for them, there we go. Just going to add another worker. Imagine, you know, someone in Ops has gone and provisioned a new server that they want to add to the cluster. So again, it's running those same set of pre-flight checks. So how Kismatic works, how the toolkit works, is it basically runs a set of smoke tests at the beginning, provisions the component or the cluster, and then runs a set of smoke tests at the end. So it's the same kind of process. It's going to add a certificate. Then it's going to go ahead and do the same kind of stuff.
Is this not really similar to what KubeDM is trying to do now?
Yeah, pretty similar for this bit, but.
Even for the initial bit, I mean, it's pretty similar. Apart from configuring your ingresses and all of that stuff. But if I imagine KubeDM in its final form, it will be like this.
Potentially, yes. But it's obviously not the final form yet. So
okay.
There's other things that are coming as well that KubeDM may or may not do. So it may or may not provision Gloucester, for example. It may not add Prometheus and stuff like that. There's additional things that are coming. There's going to be a set of defaults that we'll provide out of the box. This is just the very initial stages. Only a couple of months worth of it.
How extensible is this? I mean, for instance, if I would want to extend the pre-flight checks or the smoke checks, is that possible?
Yeah, if you know Go, then yes. It's the at the end of the demo, basically, the whole Kismatic Enterprise Toolkit is open source. So you can fork it and run your own service smoke tests. We added a worker node in just over a minute and a half. What's coming on the roadmap? So like I said before, we're going to do automated cluster upgrades. So that's both patch and miner. We're going to do dynamic storage bootstrapping as well. So for stateful applications, we're going to use Gloucester for that. And then, like I said to the gentleman at the back, we're going to add more defaults to this. So we're going to add Linkerd, we're going to add vaults for secrets, Prometheus for monitoring. And we're going to do an improved management of this. So we're actually going to build a UI and then have some kind of default cluster size templates for if you want to run this locally on your laptop or whether you want a full scale production system. Any questions? Ask the English, please, because I don't speak Dutch. Hey.
How easy it is to discover what exactly is the under the hood? Is there read some report or do we?
Yeah, so there's everything's basically on the GitHub repo. There's diagrams and everything of how it runs.
That's pretty important.
Yeah, so there's actually this diagram as well, which basically explains everything that's going on. Yeah, we can talk about that afterwards.
How are you handling kind of like each CD backups?
Currently, there is no way to provide backups or anything like that. That's going to be specific to the client.
Yeah.
This is simply just for provisioning at the moment. Anyone else? No? Okay, cool. Thank you very much, and let's go have a drink.